Well, hello and welcome back to Engineering 202 Electrical Fundamentals. I want to go through this sample exam here. This is sample exam number one in preparation for exam number one. You can actually find this exam on the website along with the solutions to the exam. If somehow you've come here and don't know where the website is, I'll put the web address for that site in the description of the video. If it's a little hard to follow here, I realize even though I've enlarged this, the text is a little blurry. I'm going to be posting the PDF of this on that website, and I will there's also the test itself that you can print out. Having said that, I would highly recommend that you try the test on your own first. So if you haven't done that, stop the video, print it out, spend an hour. Try it on your own, see how you come out before you look at the solutions or you watch this video. So the please bear with my coughing. I'm trying to wrap up a cold here. Well, let's go ahead and get started then. So the first problem wants us to come up with the RMS value. So if we look at an equation for RMS, this is current, so it would be IRMS is going to be equal to the square root. There's your root, and then your average, so 1 over the period, and then I'm going to integrate this from T0 to T0 plus T, and the function is current, so it's be I squared T dt. So I'm going to take my function, I'm going to say that this is T0, and I'm going to say that this is then T0 plus T. That would mean that this is one period here, T. Let me also parameterize the function between there. You could do it with the equation of a straight line, y is equal to mx plus b. I think I'll just do it by inspection here. The slope of this, it's got a rise of 10, a run of 1, so I could say that this was 10t. If I put 0 in there, I get the right answer. If I put 1 in there, I get the right answer. It's linear in between, so I think I'm good. This one is a bit trickier. Again, it has the same slope, so we're going to have 10t, but when you put 1 in there, you're going to end up at 10 rather than minus 10, so maybe I should subtract 20, and you could rationalize this also from, it does have a y-intercept down there. Now, does that work? If we put 1 in here, 1 times 10 minus 20 gives me a minus 10. 2 times 10 minus 20 gives me 0. It's linear in between. So I think we are good with that. And then lastly, this one is 0. And we'll talk a little bit about that before we wrap up the problem here. So I'm going to break this function up here, that integral, into a few pieces, and I'm going to say that the first piece for this one is the integral from 0 to 1, and when I square that current, that's pretty easy, 100 t squared dt, which is going to give me 100 divided, or 100 t cubed divided by 3, evaluated at 0 and 1, right? Which is going to give me 100 over 3. So that's for the first part. Then the second part I need to be quite a bit more careful of. That is squaring this function here. So let me purposely do that. I'm going to have 10t minus 20. And I need to square it like that. I don't want to fall into the the trap of that it's 100 t squared minus 400. No, I need to be more careful with that. And it turns out to be, 100 t squared minus 400 t plus then 400. So that's what that looks like. And then I can integrate that. So I'm going to integrate from 1 to 2. I'm going to integrate 100 t squared minus 400 t plus 400, and I've still got the dt. Okay, so that turns out to be equal to 100 t cubed divided by 3 minus 400 t squared over 2 plus 400t, and this whole thing then is going to be evaluated at 1 and 2, and we've got a non-zero lower limit, so we have to be careful of that. Well, when you go through that, and I won't belabor it, but when you go through that, you should come up with, what are you going to come up with there? 0.33, is that right? I think so. 0.33. And this is actually equal to 0.33. So, lastly, if I do this, the integral, of course, from 2 to 3 of 0 squared dt is just equal to 0. So now I need to look at the square root of, what, the period, which is 3. It's not 2, it's 3. So 1 over 3 times then, what are we going to have? 0.33 for this one. 0.33 for that one, plus 0 for that one, and let's see what we come up with there. Should come up with 4.71. Let me double check that work. I gave you, this should be 33, shouldn't it? Let me get rid of this. A little hasty here. There we go. 33, 100 over 3 is 33.33. And this one turns out to be 33.33. Okay, so now I have 33.33. Clean this up a little bit. So 33.33 plus 33.33 plus 0. Now we should get into where we want to. Yeah, now we've got that 4.71 amps. Now, does that make does that check out? It we know it's got to be between these two values here, right? Plus and minus 10. That seems to make sense. It's probably going to be quite a ways from 10 because we spend quite a bit of the wave at zero. Right? So I think we're okay with that 4.71. So let's see the RMS value. 4.71, we can take A. So if the current flowing through a is flowing through a 10 ohm resistor, what's the average power being dissipated? Well, let's see. Power is equal to, we want to use the we don't want to use the half term because we're not talking about a sinusoidal function. We want to use RMS. So I've got I RMS times R. This would be I RMS squared times R. It's one of our old friends there. So we could say that this is 4.71 squared times a resistance of 10, which gives me 222 watts. Okay, answer C. Then I think there's one more question on this. If the current's flowing through a 250 millihenry inductor, what's the average power being dissipated? Ah, key word here, average power. What dissipates average power? Only resistors, right? So the answer here would, of course, be D, zero. Okay, so that one is pretty easy. Let's see, I think we've got that done. One thing we might talk about is how could you get more power out of this thing? If we were to reduce this time here, where it's zero, you can see mathematically that if we were to, instead of dividing by 3, only divide by 2.5 or something, this number here would increase. So that's something to think about when you look at a wave, how much time it spends there at zero. Well, let's go ahead and move on to question number 4. It said, use the following circuit for problems 4 and 5. And basically, they give you this voltage across here, which is going to be essentially this voltage here. And they give you the voltage across here, which would be the voltage there with respect to ground. And this begins to look a great deal like what we did in laboratory, in the first lab, as we try and find out what that element is and whatnot. So let's look at those numbers. We're told that determine the impedance Z of the element if Vs is 10 at 35. Got this here. Got too many papers. Here we go. So we've got 10 at 35. That's volts. And V1 is 3 at 0. And that's also volts. And if this is 1K ohm. Okay, so we'll see if we can figure this out. Well, we can say that I, this current through here, I would be equal to 3 at 0 divided by 1,000, right? So I have 0.003 at 0. And then if I want to talk about this voltage here, let's call this V, I could say, and doing just very similar to what we did in laboratory number 1, you go back and look at that, that's going to be this total voltage here, 10 at 35, minus this voltage here, 3 at 0, which gives me, if you grab your calculator, should be 7.736 at 47.85. And incidentally, you know, if you're not comfortable doing that with your calculator is not supporting you in that, that's a good indication that we want to change things up before the exam. Well, we know then by Ohm's law that impedance is equal to the voltage divided by the current. So we've got 7.736 at 47.85, and we're going to divide that by the current, 0.003 at 0, because I put this in ohms. I turned that 1K to 1,000 ohms. And we have a number here coming out in rectangular form, 1730 plus J, 1912 ohms. Okay, so before we go and try and answer the question, it looks like it's resistive and inductive, right? It's positive, so resistive and inductive. So let's see what we get with this then. It says determine the impedance. So what do we have here? 1730 plus J, 1912. That's negative. 1730 plus J, 1912. Looks like we've got answer B. What best describes what Z is? See, resistive, no, not capacitive. Resistive, inductive, purely resistive. Well, if it's purely resistive, this wouldn't be here. Purely capacitive, nope. Purely inductive, well, if it's purely inductive, the resistive wouldn't be there. So I think we can say, as we surmised a while ago, resistive and inductive. So we had B on both of those. So answer B on both of those. Oh, good. think we're ready to hopefully move on then. So, questions 6 and 7 and I think 8 are based on this this circuit here. And what do we have? One thing we'll note that this is not RMS, is it? So something to keep in mind, because we're going to be talking about power, maximum power transfer. We've got the value for voltage 1. We've got the current. We've got C and L, R being 1 ohm. That's easy enough. C being minus J1, so this is in the phasor domain, isn't it? And L being J1. Okay, so let's put those in. We've got minus J1. This is 1. This is positive J1. This is 1. And what do we have for the current? 2 at 0. And voltage 12 at 30. This is amps and volts, ohms. So we're good on our units there. What's the open circuit voltage between A and B? So we're looking if this is the open circuit. So if I look at that being open circuit, I can say that the current through here, this current here, is equal to 0, right? Okay, that's going to be equal to 0. So let me go ahead and put I1 here. I'll just say that I have I1. And I'll say that I have I2 in here, being consistent with the solutions that you might look at. Well, I should be able to go around this one pretty easily and come up with a nice Kirchhoff's equation. This one's a little trickier because I don't know the voltage across this current source. But if I step back from it, I recognize I know a whole lot more. I know that I2 is going to be 2 at 0. So that's kind of nice. This current, we said, was equal to 0. So if I find this equation here, so I could say that I have 12 at 30. That's a gain. So let me just write 12 at 30. That's a gain, and then set it equal to all of these drops. I have 1 times I1 plus I1 times a minus J plus a J1 times this one, I1 minus I2, right? Okay, that gets me back to my starting point. That's a good equation. I could put this on the other side as a negative, set it equal to 0 if I wanted to. So what am I going to do here? I1, 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 I2. So I could substitute that into there. I could solve for I1. And when I do that, I1 turns out to be equal to 13.11 at an angle of 37.59. Okay. Now, what good is that? I've got I1 and I2. Well, I could say that V open circuit is really the voltage from there to there plus the voltage from there to there. That is this voltage here plus that voltage there, isn't it? So I could say that V open circuit is going to be equal to 1 times I2 plus then this voltage here, a minus J times I1, right? So when I go through that, putting the I2 term in that we have up there and the I1 that we just found, this goes in here, this goes in there again, and come up with V open circuit being equal to 14.42 at an angle of minus 46.10 volts. Okay, so hopefully we have one of those answers. Now 14.42, that's good. Minus 46, yeah. So it looks like answer C. What's the value? What value of ZL will allow maximum average power transfer? Okay, so we got a max power problem here. We've got V open circuit. We could go ahead and find I short circuit, so we would short this thing out and find, then set up a current in here and go back through this. But I don't think we have to do that. I mean, if we had to do it the long way, would be to find V open circuit, which we just did, then I short circuit, and we would then say that Z Thevenin is equal to V open circuit divided by I short circuit. Okay, but we don't have to do that. We can use the shortcut. Why can we use the shortcut? Because we don't have any diamonds. So no diamonds, no dependent sources. So use shortcut. Okay, what's that shortcut going to look like? I'll make this page 5. So we've got no diamonds. We're going to use the shortcut. And what is that shortcut? I open the current sources. Open the current sources and short the voltage sources. And then I look back into those terminals. So let's see what that looks like. So I short out the voltage source. I still have that resistor there. I still have that capacitor. Still have the inductor. Let's see, opening that takes that away. I'll have the resistor here. And now I'm looking back into essentially these terminals here and asking the question, what is Z equivalent? Well, it's Z Thevenin, isn't it? Okay, so this is 1, this is 1, or J1, and this is minus J1, and this is also 1. So if I look at that, I have these two are in series, so I have 1 plus J1, and that's in parallel with this one, minus J, so product over sum is 1 plus J1 minus J1. That gets me the equivalent resistance of this whole mess here, and then I just have to add 1 to that. So when you go through that, we can say that Z Thevenin is equal to 2 minus J. Okay, so it says what value of ZL will allow, now we're not quite there yet, are we? So we know for maximum power, that ZL is going to have to be equal to Z Thevenin conjugate. So I need to take the complex conjugate of that. So that's going to be equal to the complex conjugate of this is 2 plus J, isn't it? Okay. Should be 2 plus J. So what answer do I want here? 2 minus J, 2 plus J. Looks like I have a little typo here. Probably try and do better on the actual exam, but I think I'm going to, you don't get to do that necessarily on the exam, change the answer to what you want it to, but that would be the answer there, 2 plus J. Okay? So then, if we go to question number 8, what is the maximum average power that can be transferred? Okay, So we've got Z Thevenin. We've got V open circuit. So let's put this thing together. Let's model this. This is going to be V open circuit, which is going to be V Thevenin, which we calculated a while ago was 14.2 at minus 46. 14.42 at a minus 46. Okay. And then we had the Thevenin impedance, which was essentially a resistor, and because we had negative J, a capacitor, 2 minus J. And we said for maximum power transfer, we were going to have the load that would be 2, and then we had an inductor because it's going to be plus J. All right? So now we ask the question, what's the maximum average power This is real, right? So we're essentially looking at what power we can have transfer out of there. So let me talk about this current. What's this current going to be equal to? Yeah, it'd be equal to VOC divided by Z total. Well, let's see. This cancels that. So I essentially take VOC and I divide by, that cancels that. I'm dividing by 4, aren't I? Okay, so 14.42 at an angle of minus 46 divided by 4 should give me, 3.606 at an angle of minus 46. And that's amps. Okay. And I like to do current, because you could say, well, there's voltage division, but you have to be real careful of that. If you just split the voltage division, you're going to have it across these two elements. I like the current because the current goes through everything. We talked about that in lecture. So I could say that then with this, that power is equal to I squared times R, right? And you might say, well, wait a minute. This is RMS, isn't it? Do we have RMS? It's one of the problems here with only having a little paper available. Not RMS. Remember, we noted that. So, I don't want to use this. So, I'm going to use that. Maybe I'll write up the page here, get a little more room. Power is equal to, if I'm not using RMS, I've got to use 1/2 times I max squared times R. So what's that turn out to be? 1/2 times 3.606 times what resistor are we looking for the power in? That one right there too. Okay, so that turns out to be equal to 3.606 squared. So should have about 13 watts. All right, that seems a little high. Oh, right at 13. Great. So, do we have an answer there? Yeah, right there, 13. Answer A. Good. So, good solid problem, making sure that you pay attention to whether you're an RMS or you're not. We got to use the shortcut for the Thevenin. The one thing here, and on question number 7, as I change this a little bit, if you were going to be doing the test, and hopefully I don't make any mistakes on your test, you could argue that would have been a better answer there. But since we're going through this, I just put the J. There. You know, E is usually not a good one to guess, because oftentimes I use E just for this to protect the problem if there is a mistake in it. Well, let's see here. Where do we go from here? So, questions. Questions 9 and 10. Use the following circuit. Problems 9 and 10. B. Ah, we've got this in the time domain, don't we? Okay. So this is definitely not RMS. So, not RMS. It says, this is your omega, isn't it? It even has a different omega. It's running a little lower frequency. We could say that V would be equal to 100 at 20. Then L, so L Z sub L, that's going to be equal to what? J omega L, which is going to be J 314 times 0.0 or 0.100, which gives us then 31.4, yeah, J 31.4. And how about Z sub C, which is going to be minus J over omega C, which would be minus J divided by 314 times what's C, 20 micro, 20 times 10 to the minus 6, gives me 314, 20, yeah, minus J, 159. So that's good. So I've got this here, 100 at 20 volts, and we're asked, what's the what is the total average power supplied by the voltage source? What's the total reactive power supplied by the voltage source? So by far the fastest way to do this problem is to talk about the complex power that's being supplied by this source. And I could say that that complex power would be equal to VRMS times IRMS conjugate. But really, we're not in RMS, so maybe we need to be careful with that. We could say that it was could I use 1/2 times V times I conjugate? I think I could, because V divided by the square root of 2 and is VRMS. I divided by the square root of 2, I still take the conjugate. So I think I will use that one. We've got V, so I just need to find I. I need to find what the current I is here. Well, we know that I, our game plan, I is going to be equal to the voltage V, what we've got there, divided by the total impedance on this thing. A little ugly there. Okay. So I really need to come up with a total impedance on this thing. So let's see. What is Z total going to be? Well, I have two branches, so I could just do a product over sum, couldn't I? So what do we have here? We've got 1,000. This is 1,000. This C we said was minus J 159, and this L was J 31.4. So I could say that I have a product over sum is going to be 1,000 plus J 31.4. I multiply that by 1,000 minus J 159, and then I have 1,000 plus J 31.4 plus 1,000 minus J 159. And that's for all of this, and I guess I just need to add this one. This is another 1,000, isn't it? So if I add 1,000 here, I should be get the impedance for the whole thing. So you run through this, you've got 2,000 minus J, what, 127, something like that. Do this multiplication here, turn that over to your calculator, and this number should turn out to be equal to 1504.8 at an angle of minus 1.204. It's intermediate step, so I'll keep quite a few decimals there. Double check that, make sure that you can get that. So I could say then that I would be equal to 100 at 20 divided by this Z, which turns out to be equal to 0.0665 at 21.2. Let me double check that with the calculator there real quick. So we're good at that. Now, we haven't taken the conjugate of this, so we want to be careful with that. Let's get a little more paper here. So I could say then, I think we said that we were going to do that S was equal to 1/2. Get this one down here. We were going to do 1/2 times V times I conjugate. So I have then 1/2 times V, which is 100 at 20, times I. And then when I take the conjugate of I that we found, we're going to have 0.0665. And then I need to have, what, a minus 21.2. Okay. So we'll go through that. We should be able to come up with an S there. So we go through the math here. We've got 3.322 minus J 0.0698. And that would be volt amps, right? That whole thing would be volt amps. So this is the real power, this is the reactive power. So we were looking for then what's the total average power, so that's real power, so 3.32. We could say answer B would be the appropriate answer there. What's the total reactive power? Right there, so it's negative 0.0698. How about minus 0.07? I think that's close enough. It would not be a good choice to take E between these two. So this one would easily round back to this one. So we have answer C there. So we got that wrapped up. Now, I think that's probably the easiest way to do this problem, the fastest way to do this problem. But you might check yourself if you wanted to. You could come up with the current in here. You could come up with the current in here. I mean, you could take this current right here and do current division, couldn't you? Okay. So if you took that current and did current division, this one turns out to be equal to 0.51036 at an angle of 15.82, and this current here turns out to be 0.0332 at an angle of 26.65. We'll just say 26.7. Now, why would I want those currents? Well, if I wanted to figure out the total average power supplied, I could take this resistor times this current squared, divide it by half, because again, we're not RMS. This current here squared times this resistor, divide it by a half, add those together, and then they take this total current here, 0.0665 squared times the 1,000, divide it by half, add those up, and what number should we get? We should get that number right there. Okay. Now, for the reactive power, what would we do? Well, we would take this number, square it, multiply it by the half, and then multiply it by this 31.4, and we would add that to this number, 0.0332 squared, multiplied by this minus, keep the minus in there, 159, and then you're going to have to divide it by 2, because again, it's not RMS. When you then take the power out of here, the reactive power out of there, and add it to the reactive power out of there, you can, would come up, and I double check this, with that number there. So you could tackle this like I showed you here, finding the real and reactive power that is supplied, or we know it would be the same as the real and reactive power that's absorbed, which I have to then find out the real power dissipated in the resistors and the reactive power dissipated in the inductor and capacitor. So you could do it either way. I think it's much faster to do it this way, but if you broke it up and looked at the loads, and you might want to double check that, convince yourself of that. That would be a good exercise. So take these problems, take a blank piece of paper, play with them, see if you can get the same answers as you prepare for the examination. So thank you for watching, and take care till then.